that will give him all. No matter how small your arms may seem to you, because a little becomes much as you place it in the Master's hands. Just ordinary people, ordinary people. My God uses ordinary people. He chooses people that will give him all.
Thank you for the prelude, Just Ordinary People. Greetings. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Psalms 91, verse 1. Good morning. Good morning, children of God, especially the saints of the Presbyterian Church of St. Albans, the saints in the Presbyterian Church of Springfield Gardens, the saints in Throop Memorial Presbyterian Church, Westminster Presbyterian Church in Cedar Manor, First Presbyterian Church in Far Rockaway, First Presbyterian Church in Jamaica, and Dunton Presbyterian Church. On this first Sunday in the Lenten season, we have gathered as one body in the name of Jesus, to worship, praise, and glorify our God. So we welcome you into this sacred space in the name of Jesus, our Savior and Lord. Please join now in the hymn of praise, Christ is All. Amen. And now let us pray. Holy God, we invoke your spirit within us and upon us this morning. We come seeking your face, Lord, and praying to know your will for our lives. Then we will always do your will and not our own. As we start this Lenten season, please stir within us the spirit of repentance, the will to love sacrificially, and a heart of gratitude. Lord God, you call us at all times and in all places to follow you, to work with you, to abide in you as we tell others about your infinite grace and mercy. We confess this morning that fear often keeps us from answering your call. Instead of praising you, we have been silent. Instead of being true disciples, we have been hesitant to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. Most Holy Father, forgive us. Cover us both outwardly and inwardly under the shadow of your wings. Replace our despair with hope and praise. Empower us to be bold and not afraid. Defend and protect us from all adversities that hurt the body, and cleanse us from all evil thoughts which afflict and pollute the mind. Holy Spirit, we are assured that you, O God, count us worthy of our calling, for we have claimed Jesus as our Savior, Yahweh as our refuge and strength, and the Most High God as our dwelling place. We give you all the honor, glory, and praise, even as we lift this prayer in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Please join now in the hymn of preparation. You can tell the world. And now the prayer for all peoples will be lifted by Minister Hale Thompson of the Hollis Presbyterian Church.
Good morning, saints of God. This morning, as we lift the body of Christ in prayer, we make special intercession for the saints in the Presbyterian churches of Southeast Queens. This morning, we lift prayers for Daphne Cheely and family, Sadie Morris and the entire Hollis Presbyterian Church family, for Deacon Fred Miles, Elder Johnny Efferson, Clarence Whittingham, Barbara Cheatham, Audrey Brooks, and for the Reverend Dr. Edward Davis and the PCSA family. For Amber Green, Florence H. Forsyth, and the First Presbyterian Church of Far Rockaway. For Sister Miriam Lindsay, Sister Lovey, Sister Inez Graham, Sister Stacy Brown, and the seniors in the Throop Memorial Presbyterian Church family. For Sister Joan Moody, Ann Murphy, Sadie Humphrey, Linda Williams, Lena Hunter, and the entire Springfield Gardens Presbyterian Church family. For the family of David Lucas, the family of Elaine Spivey, and the Westminster Presbyterian Church family. For the Reverend Patrick O'Connor and the First Presbyterian Church family in Jamaica. And for Brother Leonard Owens, Elder Janine Mercer, and the Reverend Desmond Brown and the entire Dunton Presbyterian Church family. At this time, I'd like you just to settle yourselves in, saints. Take a deep breath and release it. As we come into the presence of God, let's center ourselves to receive the Holy Spirit this morning. And the hymn says, "He speaks and the sounds of his voice is so sweet the birds hush their singing. And the melody that he gave to me within my heart is ringing. For he walks with me and he talks with me and he tells me I am his own. And the joy that we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known." Let us pray. Father God, we come before you, praising you for your omnipotence, for your omniscience, for your grace, for your mercy, all which is unfavored being brought to us. Lord, we thank you for coming forward this morning to bless this church, bless our homes and our hearts, God. We thank and praise you for guiding us through this time of pandemic, Lord. We thank and praise you for keeping our minds stress-free during this terrible midwinter blues period that we're going through now, God. Lord, we want to thank you for the dedication of the saints who come together each week to produce this virtual service. Lord, I especially lift in prayer our videographer, Brother Grigson Smith, who comes every week faithfully. For Sister Rich Burrow, who comes preparing the service. And we thank you and we praise you. Lord, sometimes my heart is heavy. But Lord, I thank you for the heaviness of my heart, for the emotion that comes on me, Lord. I just thank you, Lord. For the times where I don't know where I'm going, God, I thank you for the guidance that you give me, Lord. For the times I'm walking blindly through this life, Lord, and you are at my right hand guiding me and leading me, Lord. Lord, I thank you for so many things. I forget sometimes how grateful and merciful you are. Lord, I thank you for our pastors of these churches, Lord, of all the world's churches who are striving to keep some sort of semblance of order in their churches, Lord. But we know something, Lord, you're changing. You're making a great move in our churches, God, and just ready us for the acceptance of this change. We don't know what it's going to be, Lord. We just know we're not going to be the same that we left. When we came out of our services to this format, we're not going to go back the same way, Lord. And I thank you for the change. We welcome the change, Lord. We welcome the Holy Spirit coming in our lives. Lord, there are so many things that we're not worthy to receive, but you are always ready to bless us regardless of what we do, Lord. Our sinful lives, we need to repent, Lord, and we repent this morning for all we have done that may not be favorable in your sight, Lord. Lord, I thank you for the ability to stand here. I thank you for my teachers in the academy. I thank you for the teachers who are educating our children and our students, Lord. They have a hard task, Lord, and it's by your guidance and your mercy that they are able to sustain their craft. Lord, these churches may be empty from people inside, but the Spirit is still here, Lord. I ask you to transfer this Spirit, Lord. Or rather, Lord, prepare our homes to receive the Holy Spirit directly, Lord. For on the day of your crucifixion, Father God, then Jesus died on the cross. The veil of the temple was torn open. Hallelujah. The veil was ripped. And for now, we can come to you directly. Father God. Father God, my heart's a little heavy today, Lord. But Lord, I thank you, and I stand here to give you praise and glory and honor. Lord, as I walk this journey, as we walk this journey, Lord, the rest of this week, Lord, keep us safe, despite this weather that we're dealing with, Lord, keep us safe. Insulate us, Lord, not only in the heat of our homes, but in your loving bosom, Lord. And fold your arms around us, lift us up, Lord. We need your blessings, we need your prayer. We thank you, Lord, for all you have done, for all you will continue to do in our lives. Lord, as I end this prayer this morning, I want you to bless us, Lord, if it's your holy will, to bless us, to rain down the manna from heaven upon us, Lord, that we need so greatly this day, Lord. Not that we're greedy for the blessings, Lord, but give us what we need each day of our lives so we may get through this journey of sound mind, of sound body, and whole spirit, lifting and praising and anointing your name through the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Lord, we ask these things through these three in one persons that give you glory, give you the honor, and give you the praise. Let all God's children say, amen.
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 God's holy word comes to us from the Old Testament book of Genesis. Genesis chapter 9, reading verses 8 to 17. Then God spoke to Noah and to his sons with him, saying, "And as for me, behold, I establish my covenant with you and with your descendants after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the cattle, and every beast of the earth with you, of all that go out of the ark, every beast on the earth. Thus I establish my covenant with you. Never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of the flood. Never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth." And God said, "This is the sign of the covenant which I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for perpetual generations. I set my rainbow in the cloud, and it shall be for the sign of the covenant between me and the earth. It shall be when I bring a cloud over the earth that the rainbow shall be seen in the cloud. And I will remember my covenant, which is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. The water shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. The rainbow shall be in the cloud, and I will look on it to remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is on the earth." And God said to Noah, "This is the sign of the covenant which I have established between me and all flesh that is on the earth." Here ends the reading. The New Testament reading comes to us from the book of 1 Peter, chapter 3, reading verses 18 to 22. Verse 18. "For Christ also suffered once for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive by the Spirit, by whom also he went and preached to the spirits in prison, who formerly were disobedient when once the divine longsuffering waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is, eight souls, were saved through water. There is also an antitype which now saves us, baptism, not the removal of the filth of the flesh, but the answer of a good conscience toward God through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, angels and authorities and powers having been made subject to him. Here ends the reading. Thanks be to God. And now, the sermonic selection, Ride On, King Jesus.
Christ, the first and last, no man works like him, for he is King of King, Lord of Lord. Jesus Christ, the first and last, no man works like him. King Jesus rides on a milk-white horse, no man works like him. The river of Jordan he did cross, no man works like him, for he is King of King, Lord of Lord. Jesus Christ, the first and last, oh, King Jesus rides in the middle of the air, everywhere. Oh, ride on, King Jesus. No man can hinder me. Ride on, King Jesus. Ride on, no man can hinder me. He is the King.
The sermon this morning, Inside Out, will be preached by Minister Eric Toodles.
Good morning. I want to thank our liturgist, Elder Raymond, for reading the scripture. And I want to thank Chaplain Charles Powell for that wonderful song, Ride On, King Jesus. Good morning. My name is Minister Eric Toodles from the Presbyterian Church of St. Albans. Pray with me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh upon your people. Open their ears and their hearts to receive the word that you have placed inside me. Lord, I ask that you take this, your humble servant. Hide me behind your cross. Fill me with your spirit, so that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart will be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my Redeemer and my Rock. Amen. Inside Out. If you read the first chapter of Genesis, you will see that something is horribly wrong. What we see is God's creative activity, where we go from chaos to God's creative order. He speaks and things appear. At the sixth day, God looked over his creation and declared everything good. But by the time we get to the sixth chapter of Genesis, the writer notes in verse 5 that the Lord saw that the wickedness of his humankind was great in the earth, and that every inclination of the thoughts of their hearts were only evil continually. The question I would ask is that when you have an idea and you turn that idea into a project and that project fails or fall apart, how do you react? Do you become frustrated, angry, or just give up? Or do you say something like this, if I don't find a solution to the situation, then I'll quickly lose interest and drop the project. Well, I myself go through a period of doubt, saying that idea was no good in the first place. But I can assure you, though God does not. The manner in which the Lord reacts to his creative degradation carries with it a powerful message of good news, of gospel for you and I. The Lord did not respond in anger. The writer of Genesis records that the Lord was very sorry that he had made mankind on the earth, and he grieved him to his heart. Out of that grief, God moved in a loving manner to restore his creation. I think we may all understand that a little bit of what the Lord was experiencing. For those of you who are parents, have you grieved in your heart at the harmful decisions your children have made and how those decisions have affected them? As we too have gone through life, we have grieved over many things, such as a battered, bruised and broken relationship, lost jobs, lost wages, as well as many other things. Although we have gone through those grievances, we long for healing and restoration. The pain and the suffering that we see our family members and friends go through also pierce our hearts as well. Even out of the Lord's grief, he moved on in his creation. He did not react in angry judgment, and his purpose was not annihilation or genocide, but God moved to restore his creation. God washed the earth clean, and both God and the earth began anew. God took what he had, flawed human beings, and we all are, and gave them a new beginning. What a dramatic picture of the Christian life. Like the flood of Noah, God washed us in the waters of baptism. God takes the old in us and make a new of us. Let me repeat that. God takes the old in us and makes a new in us. God brings us into a new relationship with him. Order is created out of chaos, and hopelessness becomes forth from the spear. As we travel this Lenten journey, we demonstrate this. We move from our brokenness and separation to the resurrection and the life, victory over sin, death, and the devil. God initiated this covenant. God enters into eternal covenant with all creation without requiring us to do anything in return. Because if he did, we would miss the mark. God does so fully aware that the inclination of the human heart is evil from youth still. The divine heart was so aggravated by human weakness, it now moved by the same grief to seek another way to get through to us. We close the door on God, but God finds a way to get in. We turn our back on God, but yet God still comes and he knocks at our door. God promised to us is by the covenant sign of the rainbow, never to destroy the creation by water. The implication of this promise is that God will try everything else before that again. God will seek us and seek us, despite or perhaps because of God's knowledge of every sin, every grief, and every shame that veils our vision of God's reality and of our own as God's creation. Wherever we dwell in God's heart, he keeps us from hearing the harmony of all lives in God's care. God will not give up on loving us into restoration. God continues to seek us, even when the best of times we don't seek him. That is the grace of God. God does not give up on the people that he claims as his own. God doesn't wait for us to come to him, because sometimes he'd be waiting a long time. But rather he comes to us. While we were sinners, rebellious toward God, even enemies of God, Christ died for us. God has already made his decision, and that we are his, no matter what. He made that decision. It is final. We are his. It is that spirit that now moves in our lives to convince us of this reality and to empower us to live in it. If you read 1 Peter, there he writes, Christ also suffered for sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, in order to bring us to God. He has put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which he also went and made a proclamation to the spirit in prison, who in former times did not obey. When God waited patiently in the days of Noah, during the building of the ark, and which few, that is, eight persons, were saved through water and baptism, which this imaginary now saves us. What we should be able to take away from that text in 1 Peter is that it is a lesson that we are actually ending of the story of Noah and the great flood. As a result of that lesson from 1 Peter, it is God that is really placing the rainbow in the sky when clouds threaten to remind us, not of himself or of his covenant promise never to destroy the whole earth again, but I believe that in the wisdom of God, this story of the great flood is intended to help us grasp the fact that God is the creator of the universe and that he is the ultimately in charge. He's the all and all. It tells us that just as good parents raise their children to adhere to certain standards of behavior for the sake of increasing their quality of life, so does God. And as children, when we fail to live our lives according to those standards which our parents set before us, there are consequences. The same is true for our relationship with God. As a loving creator, he would have us respect his principles for our lives, that we may live a more meaningful and joyful life and care for those around us. But sometimes we come too complacent and only care about ourselves. Sometimes we forget about our fellow man in order to boost ourselves. Sometimes we forget that God is in charge and he has to knock us down to remind us who has given us life and life to the fullest. But just as a child does not always listen to their parents, neither do we. We all have grieved God with our sins. We all have gone astray. We all have deserved punishment for our behavior. But do we all deserve to die for our disobedience, as did all of those who were drowned in the flood? Do we live on the expectation that God will be so grieved by our sins that he will not cause to die for us? I believe the answer to those two questions are no. God cares for his people, even though sometimes we don't care for God. He rescues us on the brink of disasters and reminds us who is in charge and give us life again. For you see, God will not move outside of us in order to force us into a relationship with him. God has a better plan. God will move within us to draw us towards him. We can look back in our lives and see how the Holy Spirit has moved in our lives to nudge us into a closer relationship with God. You know, we need that nudge sometimes, that push, to remind us that we have a relationship with one who sustains us, one who carries us, one who lifts us up when no one else can. We just need that nudge every now and then. The Spirit has used people, circumstances, and other experiences to remind us that we belong to God and he to us. This season of Lent offers you and I an opportunity to intentionally open up our lives and our hearts to the work of the Holy Spirit. A closed heart can't mend. A closed body cannot grow. A closed mind cannot take in new stuff. This is the time for us to see ourselves in the light of the Spirit. It is a time to evaluate our relationship. It is a time to renew and be restored. To be restored by the refreshing of the living water that God has for us. The steadfast love of the Lord overwhelms us, but it also gives us confidence to continue our Lenten journey and beyond. We do so secured in God's love and in the knowledge of that Holy Spirit it is moving in us, drawing us ever closer in our Creator and our Savior, and enabling us to experience the free and abundant life that is ours. All we have to do is give and surrender ourselves to God. He takes care of the rest. Use this Lenten season to give of yourself, of all, to be restored to a new level of life, ready to walk in God's vineyard, to be restored to the work that he has called you to do. Enjoy your Lenten journey. In Jesus' name, amen. We now open the doors of the church. Invite those that may not have a home that call their own to come and to one of the churches in Southeast Queens to gather and to learn more of our Heavenly Father, to open yourself to feel his Spirit running through you. The doors of the church are open. And as we do that, we will have our discipleship selection, I Am a Seeker for a City, by Sister Geraldine McMillan.
affirm our faith with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and in earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into Hades. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Gloria Patri. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, it's now and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
As 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7 exhorts us with these words. So let each one give as they purpose in their heart, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. The prayer line is also open right now to receive your requests and your testimonies. You can call on weekdays from 12:30 to 2 p.m. That number again is 712-770-5505. The access code, 293-822-549-pound. Thank you. The benediction today will be lifted by Minister Eric Toodles.
My people, as we leave this first Sunday in the season of Advent, I ask you to go with God's grace, be renewed by His Spirit, be uplifted by the voice that He placed in your heart. So as we leave this virtual setting, that we can come again to praise our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
The closing selection this morning is Let the Church Say Amen.